coming to a stadium near you. Featuring a cast of colorful terrestrials in a futuristic drama.
Hey, we're heading for the future. Give us some time. We're gonna make it work right. Yeah.
Headed for the future, the story of the 1986 Phillies. Testing the fruits of their off-season labors began in Clearwater, Florida. And after their first losing season in more than a decade, the Phillies had some demons to chase. A new formula seemed in order, so relievers Steve Bedrosian and outfielder Gary Reedus had been brought in to help ward off evil spirits. A third newcomer was Milt Thompson, as the Phillies searched for the nucleus of a winner.
What we were interested in was getting quality players. What Bill Giles' plan is to build a team that, let's say, will be together 8 to 10 years, and by getting these players, he's hoping to accomplish that.
The experts didn't buy it, but the Phillies said, let's wait and see.
We don't necessarily have a lot more to go on right now other than optimism. We're also a team of potential. Potential means they've never done it before, however, and all I can say is the Phillies are going to be heard from in the National League East, and we're going to do some damage, if not all the damage.
The season's first sounds came from Cincinnati as the game's Old Men River squared off on opening day. Pete Rose's Reds faced John Felsky's lustrous lefty, but Steve Carlton's 14th opening day start was a bust.
That's it. Well, back in the deep right field.
The day was a portent of sorts, for at age 41, Lefty seemed the master no more. The Reds' 7-4 rout was on one hand the beginning of the end. But for the Phil's other immortal, it was just the start of something big. In his 14th big league season, Mike Schmidt was embarking on an unforgettable odyssey. But first, the preliminary between a heavyweight and an overweight. The psychological warfare began early. But if the Phillies were truly going to be a contender, a lot of questions would have to be answered in the early season. For instance, what about the switch hitting experiment of the Phillies shortstop, Steve Jeltz, who after all was a career 191 hitter?
Swing and a drive into right center. It's a gapper going all the way back to the fence. Jeltz heading for third. He's there with a triple.
Jeltz was the key figure in a tumultuous 14-inning affair with the Mets. It was only April, but it was the kind of game in which a young team could conceivably come of age.
Swing and a smash, base hit, center field, game's over. Phillies win it by a score of 9-8 on an RBI single by Steve Jeltz.
But the game also had its share of lows alongside the exhilarating high of a dramatic come-from-behind win. Juan Samuel strained a rib cage muscle and would miss 15 games. And recurrent back problems finally forced Gary Maddox to call it quits. The Phillies' Secretary of Defense had been one of their most popular players. The gold glove and good cheer of Gary Maddox would be sorely missed. Yet another sad goodbye came from Joe LaFay, whose retirement paved the way for the return of Jeff Stone from Portland. The problem was, with all these players moving up and down, the Phillies just couldn't seem to get settled in the early going. Near the end of May, the Phillies were 15-24 in dead last. The skipper was being second-guessed, of course, and players developed their own self-doubts, their own frustrations. Mets were running away with the Eastern Division race, but there were still 4 months to play, and the challenge was to summon up a pride in one's own performance, to find the strength as a team to rise from the bottom and salvage a measure of respectability and a glimmer of hope. At the edge of darkness, there is always a clearing. It's just a question of getting there. One Philly who stood tall during the dark days of May and seemed to have finally arrived was first baseman Bon Hayes. And his bat got hotter as the season progressed. It was only the fifth full season for Hayes, fourth with the Phillies. And once he hit his stride, folks forgot about those five players it took to get him. Hayes became a trusty first baseman and put up the kind of stats the players call a career year.
Well, the numbers, you know, are definitely pleasing, but what I try to do this year is develop a stance and an approach that can keep me consistent day in and day out. I've been steadily just picking away and trying to help the team every day, and I'm more pleased with this season than definitely any other season.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised to see Bon Hayes win a Triple Crown. That's the kind of ability he has and determination that he has.
Hayes topped the league with 46 doubles and 107 runs scored. His three Player of the Week honors in one season is matched only by Hank Aaron. At age 28, old 5-for-1 should be the toast of the vet for a long time to come. The Phillies were looking to find another bright spot behind the plate, with a platoon featuring Darren Daulton as the defensive stalwart. Before an injury ended his season in June, Daulton also showcased a real talent for the long ball, something the Phillies already knew about John Russell, the other half of the catching team. If Russell keeps improving on D, there may be a place for his clutch bat in the lineup, and the Phillies will have come closer to solving one of their chief concerns. Another problem solver for the Phillies was Shane Rawley, who blossomed into one of the league's most reliable starters in the season's first half. Even the team's early season woes couldn't diminish Rawley's blithe spirit, and the left-hander racked up 7 straight wins. It seemed the gunfights were all going Shane's way, and the young lad earned a spot on the All-Star team with an 11-4 record. A shoulder injury sidelined Rawley in late July, but not before he took his place among the game's top left-handers. Of course, there were some pretty big shoes to fill in that department. On June 21st, Steve Carlton surrendered 6 runs to the Cardinals in just 5 innings. His record stood at 4-8. His ERA ballooned to 6.18, and the Phillies, struggling to reach the 500 mark, simply ran out of patience. Lefty was a Philly no more.
The Steve Carlton era has ended in Philadelphia. The greatest left-hand pitcher in Philly's history, and one of the greatest pitchers of all time, will no longer be pitching. In Philadelphia.
Tears and sadness gave way to reflection, and in a revealing postseason chat, Lefty looked back at his career and the pitch that made it happen.
Nobody ever taught me the slider. You know, when I started working with it, it was probably 1968, I probably was played around with a little bit. Then the Cardinals went to play the Japanese teams in 1968, and we were over there, and Sadaharu, it hit a home run off me. So I thought, well, I'm going to intimidate this guy. So I started throwing the slider, and I threw it right at him, right in his ribs. And he just, he flew back like this, and a ball came over the plate for a strike, and then I knew I had him. So I really saw how effective a pitch like that could be.
Carlton became an All-Star in his second full season with the Cardinals. Then after winning 20-71, he became a Philly. So how'd young Lefty take the news?
Panic. They woke me up about 9 o'clock in the morning. Bing Devine called me, and he told me, he said, I want to be the one to break the news to you that we decided that we're going to trade you, or have traded you to Philadelphia. And I said, Bing, can we reconsider, I said, and he said, no, it's already been done, you traded for Rick Wise earlier this morning or last night or something. And I was panic stricken, I didn't know what, going to a Phillies were in last place, and that at that time. And the Cardinals were always competing for first place, and you think, oh my God, Dredd, there goes your career. So But it turned out it was a blessing in disguise because I got off to a real good start, then I lost like three or four games in a row, then I came back and won 15 games in a row. But pitching every fourth day, once I hit that stride, I mean, I just made incredible pitches. I never threw a ball down the heart of the plate. I just constantly worked the corners, and it was just so easy, like pitching a forte, to have that rhythm and that pace, and control was just incredible.
It wasn't arrogance, just being the best, that Carlton taught the Phillies. And in the mid-70s, the team began to assemble a supporting cast worthy of their peerless left-hander.
Paul Owens and Willie Carpenter really, you know, out of their minor league system and you know, making some key trades. They had, you know, put together a dominant team, you know, and it's fun to go out there knowing that you're going to win. To know that you've got a lot of the trump cards with the team they had assembled, those were fun years.
But Carlton never lost his perspective.
The beauty of sports is in the doing, you know, the excellence of doing. And that's, you know, it frightens me in a way to just stop and think about, you know, what you're doing, because you get trapped. You know, I just rather nice going, put it aside, you know, what do we got next? You know, that's the way I look at sports or you know, life in general, you know, just it's a constant battle of, you know, of excellence and putting excellence behind you and striving further.
Steve Carlton achieved what very few athletes dare even dream. For the glories of his time, we're forever grateful.
It was a great 14 years, and I would like to thank everybody for their support. Those are the years that you'll always remember. Those are great years. You know, the fans being there and the cheering and all that. But just thank you for a great, you know, 14 years.
As Lefty continued his career elsewhere, Phillies pitching coach Claude Osteen was left desperately seeking another ace for his staff.
The Phillies will bring up Bruce Ruffin. He's a left-hander from double-A ball, and that is a heck of a jump and very hard to make.
Introducing a 22-year-old Texan with plenty of stuff. Now, these weren't minor leaguers he was facing anymore, but someone forgot to tell Bruce Ruffin. It's a name to remember, for Ruffin won 9 games after being called up and acted like he'd learned about cool from another lefty.
Big part of Bruce Ruffin is the fact that he has such tremendous poise, besides the talent.
Outwardly, he doesn't seem to get too high in victory and not too low in defeat.
Still, there was no hiding the excitement over Bruce Ruffin's future. And then there was the day of future pass for Don Carmen, who had his brush with history one sleepy afternoon in the city by the bay. There was no disguising this tete-a-tete as Don Carmen slayed one giant after another. Sure, he had a little help from his friends, but this day belonged to Carmen. struck him out. That's a career-high 8 strikeouts, and through 7 innings, Don Kahneman now is 6 outs away from a perfect game. And then there were 3 outs to go, but oh, those last 3 can be so tough to come by, as Milt Thompson will attest. So for Don Kahneman, it was just another outing, a routine one-hitter. But even if it's lost on future generations, the game secured Kahneman's spot as a starter. Now, some players are always looking to better themselves, but for the first 2 months of the season, Glenn Wilson was just trying to stay in the lineup. He was hitting under 200, and only his stellar defense and the manager's patience allowed Wilson to climb out of his slump.
As far as what I'm pleased with was the fact that I was able to come back from the 2 bad months that I had. Being able to bounce back, put the kind of numbers that I was capable of putting on the board, was quite a joy to me. You know, and I've always said that if I'm not hitting, I want to be doing something defensively, so I'm not back over here on the bench. I like the excitement of a big game where you have a chance to throw a guy out. That's what I'm looking forward to. Hopefully next season is a playoff game where there's a lot of people in the stands and there's a fly ball with one out and a runner at third base, and I get that opportunity to see how I'm going to react under that kind of pressure.
For the second straight year, Wilson topped National League outfielders in assists, but it was a play he made from the infield in early July that was most memorable.
Right back up the middle, the play's gonna work! The play is going to work! The 5-man infield with Glenn Wilson at second base works, and we're going into the 11th inning.
I don't believe that.
Well, maybe you believe in omens. Or maybe you just think it was about time things started going their way. But by late August, the Phillies had started to click, and they climbed into second place. Baseball was fun again, but then that's what winning's all about.
People, get ready. It's time to show what you got. Players, take your places. There's only one way to the top. That victory, release that energy, and ride like the wind, with fire in your eyes, shake those butterflies, go ahead, and go for the win now, victory, victory, let the party begin, victory, victory, everybody can win.
Schmidt sends a high drive deep into straightaway center field. That ball is out of here.
Swing and a drive to deep right center. It's got a chance. Out of here. This game is over. A tremendous home run by Von Hayes, and the Phillies win in the bottom of the ninth, 8-7.
Winning breeds not only excitement, but also quiet confidence, like that exemplified by Juan Samuel. His talents are boundless. His numbers speak for themselves. Despite the early season injury, Sammy still managed to steal 42 bases, hit 16 homers, and knock in 78 runs. And at the ripe old age of 25, Juan Samuel became the first player in National League history to reach double figures in doubles, triples, home runs, and steals in each of his first 3 big league seasons.
To me, that I could hit home runs, steal bases, you know, hit a lot of extra bases, and at the end of the year, you know, those numbers just, you know, comes up like this, but it's really something, you know, exciting.
Critics point out that Sammy hit only .266 and led the league in strikeouts, but teammates recognized his value.
Juan Samuel is, to me, is the spark plug of this ball club. When he gets going, there's just no stopping the club. He plays hard every day, and you never hear him complain, and he never gets too high and never gets too low.
At second base, Sammy has had his highs and lows, but he's steadied there somewhat, and his offensive skills are so extraordinary that you can hardly wait to see what he'll accomplish next. The 86 Phils scored the second most runs in the league, but it was the matter of holding opponents to less that concerned Claude Osteen.
Good change right there. Man, you get that kind of action on it, man, you get a lot of people out.
Osteen learned more than his share of trade secrets in winning nearly 200 big league games, and he's got lots to teach the young Phillies staff.
Brains, well, he likes the ball low and in. That's the ball that he can hit out. He's got some power there. And we've had pretty good luck keeping the ball away from him left-handed.
In his fifth season as the Phils pitching coach, Osteen's tutelage paid real dividends. Several young pitchers were learning the ropes, and a dependable staff took shape.
Yeah, that's tailor-made.
The thing I've always strived for is consistency. And we did not have that the first half of the season. We had an unsettled starting rotation. Anytime you don't get pitching, you're going to have an unsettled situation. And I think that's the thing that we put together a little bit the second half.
When I was having problems at the beginning of the year, I think it was related to my mechanics. Claude and I went down the bullpen and we worked on it and took a lot of time and a lot of hard work. But I think that's what it takes to come out of slumps like that, whether it be a hitter or a pitcher. Claude has really helped me tremendously.
The efforts were instrumental in the Phils' late season surge as Steve Bedrosian became the bullpen closer that the Phils had hoped for. Bedrock's 29 saves tied a team record. And along with outfielder Milt Thompson, he made the trade for Ozzie Virgil seem like a steal. Or at least, something to hoot and holler about.
There's a town I know where the hipsters go called Bedrock. Twitch, twitch, when you get an itch, then you do the twitch in Bedrock. Twitch, twitch, cause the twitch is fine, have yourself a time in Bedrock. Twitch, twitch, it's a swinging town, so I'll see you down in Bedrock. Twitch, twitch, yeah, yeah.
Well, every bullpen ditty has its long play version. And in Kent DeKelvey, the Phils had the ideal long man out of the pen. Teek's job was to keep it close, but along the way, he won 11 games and broke Roy Face's NL marks for most relief appearances, and that's the long and short of it. Now back to that incredible odyssey of Michael Jack Schmidt. It started with a return from first base to third, his natural position. For Schmidt, it felt like coming home.
I started to sense the importance and how valuable it was to me and to a team for me to play good defense at third base, especially with three left-handed pitchers. I've carried that relaxation that I had at first base back over to third base, and for some reason this year, defensively, I feel like I have clicked and been comfortable and been confident about everything I've done at third base. I've enjoyed more than any other year in my career playing third base this year.
But if you're Mike Schmidt, the real fun's at home plate. In this remarkable Renaissance season, Schmidty had a ball. He led the league with 37 homers and 119 RBIs. And now only Babe Ruth has more home run crowns. At age 36, Mike Schmidt had a most valuable season.
I have had a very good, consistent year. I felt like I did something for the team every day. It might have been a handful of games, five, six, seven games, where I didn't compete in some way to the team's chances of winning the ball game. Anything from getting on base to hitting a single to a sacrifice fly to a good play defensively. For some reason, 1986 was a year that I'll always remember because from day one to the last day, I played good, consistent baseball.
As Schmidty quickened his assault on the record books, baseball fans everywhere awoke to the magnitude of his achievements. The Odyssey of 86 ended with Schmidt's home run total at 495, and Philly fans embraced Michael Jack as he stood on the verge of an historic milestone. There are some other reminders of history around town which Philadelphians take seriously. So when intruders showed up to besmirch the landscape, why, the host didn't take too kindly to them at all. Imagine the Mets thought they were going to have a clinching party at the vet in front of all these Phillies fans. Mike Schmidt had other ideas.
Now, that was one of the most thrilling home runs I've ever hit, to be honest with you. We had a chance to face the best pitcher in the National League. And everybody was hungry in the ball game, so Can we put it off at least one more night?
While the clinching was inevitable, the Phils hoped to give the Mets something to remember by deflating their title hopes for at least one more night.
Swing and a line drive to deep right. This ball's out of here. Home run, Von Hayes.
Okie, Wilson is two for four. Carter at first base, two outs. Ninth inning. Phils lead by a run. A stretch by Bedrosian in the pitch. Swing and a line drive. Great catch by Schilt. And the Mets will have to wait yet another day to pop the champagne cork.
The Mets weren't about to lose their cool with a 20-game lead. But if the Phils could sweep the series, they'd force the Mets to drink the bubbly in someone else's backyard. For Kevin Gross, it was a splendid challenge. The Mets were overpowered by Gross, who struck out nine on his way to a six-hit shutout and ensured the result with a little firepower of his own. It was a giddy weekend for the Phils, for sweeping a series like this can do wonders for a team's self-esteem.
You could see that our players were definitely up for the series. They definitely wanted to show the Mets that we're a heck of a ball club, too. And I think when we accomplished that, it gave our ball club some experience in that type of situation. It gave them certainly confidence that we can play with them. And I think it gave our young guys an idea of when you get into that type of situation, what it takes to win.
New York had brought back the division crown to Shea Stadium by the time the Phils showed up the following weekend. And now the Mets were embarrassed in their own park. Glenn Wilson pulled one of the oldest tricks in the book, allowing Mike Schmidt to score the winning run with monstrous ease. Then with a season series between the Phillies and Mets on the line, Marvin Freeman held the home team to one hit in seven innings. Freeman won his first big league game, clinched the season series, and earned himself a good long look in 87.
It's nice to know that we've got some young pitchers that we can either count on making the ball club in spring training or have them waiting in the wings in AAA ball next year.
The Phillies finished in second place, 11 games over 500. There was a real appreciation of how far they'd come and a genuine feeling that this was a team heading for the future.
Well, I'd just like to say that we thank you for your support all year. We've had some good baseball games, shown you some good, exciting baseball, and we're really looking forward to next year, and we hope you are too.
Just stick behind us. We're going to do the best we can and try and bring you a championship here to Philadelphia.
We're going to have one of the best offenses in the National League. We're going to be exciting to watch, and we're going to be in the thick of things the whole year. Come out and see us.
Our goal is this winter is maybe to sit down, analyze some things, and maybe go out and pick up a player here, a player there that's going to make us better. So that in 1987, it'll be us popping the champagne corks instead of the New York Mets.